Today we are going to discuss about vertigo, which is a symptom actually, not a diagnosis. And within the period that is available, I try to go through some of the important points with regard to vertigo. Let's get into the topic straight away. Vertigo actually is an illusion of movement, either self-motion in relation to the environment or vice versa. And the problem with vertigo is most patients do not complain to the doctor, I'm having vertigo, unless the patient is a medically qualified person. A normal person will not usually complain that he's got vertigo. Instead, they will complain of dizziness or faintishness or very vague symptoms. And it's up to the doctor to find out whether the patient's got vertigo most of the cases. And some of the similar symptoms I have listed up here. Vertigo actually is an illusion of movement. So first phase of evaluation actually is to recognize that your patient has got vertigo and not something else. The similar symptoms would be presyncope or disequilibrium. Disequilibrium means unsteadiness of balance. And presyncope, again, like before syncope, you will have presyncopal episodes where it's due to a poor cerebral blood flow. So the topic today is vertigo, which is an illusion of movement of self or environment in relation to the self. And there are a wide range of possible causes for this. And vertigo sometimes may associate with nausea, vomiting, and oscillopsia, meaning the visual field is shaking because of the nystagmus that is accompanying with vertigo most of the cases. And also they can have tilt illusion that is actually you feel the world is little tilted, and especially with central vertigo, and you can have head tilt as a reaction to counteract this. And some of them will have drop attacks, and this equilibrium actually is unsteadiness of the gait, which can accompany with vertigo in some of the cases. So during this presentation, I was preparing the presentation, and then I had to add the pearls. So the first pearl, of course, is to recognize that vertigo is an illusion of motion of self or environment. And I cannot talk about vertigo without showing this picture. This is the inner ear, the vestibular apparatus. All of you must be knowing about the anatomy of this. We have three semicircular canals perpendicular to each other, sensing the circular motion of the head in different planes, and sending impulses through the vestibular nerve, which has two divisions, the upper division and the lower division. The upper division carries impulses from the anterior and the horizontal canal, and the lower division carrying impulses from the posterior canal. And this information travels to the vestibular nuclei and the central vestibular nuclei and the vestibular cortex, and then processes information. So the vertigo actually has causes both central and peripheral. When you say peripheral causes, it means anything starting from semicircular canal, vestibular nerve, up to the vestibular nucleus. And anything happening in the central nervous system is supposed to be a central vertigo. So vertigo occurs from input difference. There are two vestibular apparatus on either side. They are firing in a balance mechanism. So when there's an imbalance in these systems, it brings about vertigo. So vertigo occur from peripheral causes. Those are lesions at vestibular apparatus and vestibular nerve up to the nucleus. And also it occur from central causes, that is from the lesions within the central nervous system. So looking at the causes of peripheral vertigo and the central vertigo, there are I have listed few of them. The common peripheral ones, actually the commonest is benign paroxysmal positional vertigo, which most of you all must be knowing. And then unilateral vestibulopathy, which is a newer term used for vestibular neuritis. And also labyrinthitis, they are all common. And Meniere's disease also is a common etiology. And rarely you will see things like perilymphatic fistula, that is a the fistula creating in the between the middle ear and the inner ear, causing sound waves to be carried to the vestibular sensing mechanism, so sound inducing vertigo. And then cholesteatoma erosion, herpes zoster oticus, which is called Ramsay-Hunt syndrome, the same as the Ramsay-Hunt syndrome that you all know, and otosclerosis. And among the causes for central vertigo, the commonest is transient ischemic attack or stroke. The vestibular insufficiency, this vertebral bacillar insufficiency is a term that is not used anymore. Instead, we now use posterior circulation transient ischemic attack or posterior circulation stroke. And migraineous vertigo and multiple sclerosis causing demyelinating plaques in various central nuclei responsible for balance maintenance can bring about central vertigo. And various neoplastic conditions pressing on the structures in the CP angle area also can bring about vertigo. And there are other causes which are not peripheral, neither peripheral nor central, that is psychogenic vertigo, and then medication-induced vertigo, and also cervical vertigo, which is a term commonly used, but it's not a pathological entity as such, probably a descriptive entity. So when you're doing the clinical evaluation in a patient with vertigo, the first reason why you do it, actually first thing you're going to find out is, actually, is it vertigo or something else? Symptom recognition. Just because the patient comes and say, I'm feeling dizzy, you should not turn it to vertigo. You must ask more questions to find out whether it's really vertigo or whether it's presyncope or whether it's disequilibrium or lightheadedness. If you recognize that patient's got vertigo by cross-questioning, one of the ways I ask from patients is, can you remember during childhood days when you self-turn around continuously and stop, you feel that you're having some feeling, that's the feeling that you get in vertigo. And then the next reason why you want to evaluate these patients is to find out whether they are central or peripheral pathologies. That is to find out which group the patient pathology is. And also another reason why you do clinical evaluation to find out life-threatening conditions. When someone is presenting with vertigo acutely, could be a cerebellar infarct, which could be life-threatening unless you recognize it in the immediately diagnostic. And also pick up various clinically diagnostic conditions. So our clinical evaluation is mainly targeted towards these aims, these targets. And you can find certain clinical clues in the history. Benign paroxysmal positional vertigo has a classic history. They are brief. They usually last less than a minute. And they are brought on by positional changes in the head. And sometimes we see them after head injury because of dislodgement of the otocornea. And coexisting ear symptoms like hearing loss, ear discharge, or ear fullness indicates probably there's a lesion in the inner ear or ear pathology. And the fact that it was sudden onset and associated with central other neurologic symptoms and signs may indicate that is a ischemic syndrome or a stroke syndrome. And recent head trauma or ear surgery might indicate probably maybe a perilymphatic fistula. And certain drugs, usage of certain drugs also can bring about, especially aminoglycosides, bilateral vestibulopathy, which is going to be a chronic bilateral vestibulopathy with unsteadiness and vertigo. Associated headache together with vertigo may indicate that probably a migraineous etiology. Migraineous vertigo is very common. About 10% of migraine patients are supposed to be having vertigo associated with certain attacks, some of the attacks. And if the patient is having anxiety or depression, may indicate that patient's probably having psychogenic vertigo. Tullio phenomenon is where sound or sneezing or coughing induces vertigo. Because of these two conditions can have this superior canal dehiscence. That is, you have this out of these three semicircular canals, the superior semicircular canal is lying on the edge of the temporal bone, there where it's possible that it get eroded and enter into the CSF phase. So sound waves and CSF pressure changes can get transmitted to the vestibular sensing mechanisms and indicate that patient's having vertigo. So, point number two, positional vertigo, which is characteristic of benign paroxysm positional vertigo, and it can happen with central positioning nystagmus also, but positional vertigo is not pathognomonic or specific to these etiologies. It can happen with many peripheral etiologies, but it's classically described as paroxysmal positional vertigo and central positioning vertigo. If you look at the cases of vertigo, they are broadly grouped into three. The first group is episodic vertigo, where the patient is normal in between attacks. Acute vertigo is a patient who is coming with vertigo of recent onset, still having vertigo going on for a number of hours, maybe a few days. And the third group, where patients are having vertigo going on for a number of months or years. So episodic vertigo, the commonest one is the benign paroxysmal positional vertigo, and vestibular migraine is another cause, Meniere's disease. And vestibular paroxysmia is actually, it's a counterpart of trigeminal neuralgia as with regard to vertigo. You know, trigeminal neuralgia is due to irritation of the trigeminal nerve by a vascular loop within the brain, causing intense pain. And it's treated with carbamazepine, which is a very good drug, if you call it. And vestibular paroxysmia, similarly, is due to a vascular loop compressing on the vestibular.
This one probably better than
paroxysmal vertigo. Sometimes you can have brief episodes of vertigo, number of attacks for a day. There's no diagnostic test for this. But if you treat them with carbamazepine, it's very sensitive. You can treat them quite well with carbamazepine or oxcarbazepine, either one or the other. And transient ischemic attack affecting vestibular structures within the central nervous system can produce vertigo, but they will have other central nervous system manifestations as well. Some of them, central mechanisms, even with TIA or strokes, they can sometimes present with isolated vertigo, small percentage, without having any other neurological manifestations. If you look at the acute vertigo group, vestibular neuritis, which is now termed as unilateral vestibulopathy, is due to a viral or post-viral mechanism causing inflammation of the vestibular nerve, giving rise to vertigo. It can happen on one side or both sides. When happening both sides, we call it bilateral vestibulopathy. And vestibular pseudoneuritis presentations clinically is like vestibular neuritis. And the signs also will be like that. But it's actually, there's a lesion in the vestibular nuclei, the central nervous system. It's actually a central nervous system pathology giving rise to vestibular neuritis-like picture. Labyrinthitis is similar to vestibular neuritis together with cochlear involvement. So you have hearing loss together with vestibular neuritis. So if someone is having clinically vestibular neuritis together with hearing loss, probably the diagnosis is labyrinthitis. So stroke can affect peripheral structures around this inner ear also, leading to infarction of the semicircular canal and vestibular apparatus and so on. And thiamine deficiency, another one for acute vertigo. As for chronic vertigo, bilateral vestibulopathy due to aminoglycoside poisoning, you damage the vestibular nerve, patient going to live with it. They will lose their vestibular ocular reflex. They find it very difficult to walk around, look at things, and they're having this equilibrium and vertigo, and it's going to be a long-term problem for it. And chronic subjective dizziness is a psychogenic form of it, which is also common, where you need to manage the anxiety and the depression component, and then cerebellar degeneration and the posterior fossa neoplasms. You may find clues in examination. Herpes zoster in the external ear may indicate that Ramsay-Hunt syndrome affecting the vestibular nerve as well. An otoscopy carried out by ENT doctors can find various inner ear pathologies. Henebert sign actually is for perilymphatic fistula, where there is a connection between the inner ear and the middle ear, and external pressure on the tragus produces vertigo, which indicates probably the patient is perilymphatic fistula. Nystagmus is a very important sign in a patient with vertigo. We'll be talking more about nystagmus in subsequent slides. And how should you look for nystagmus? The age-old method of looking for nystagmus is, keep looking at my finger, and you place your finger in the central position and extremes of the gazes up and down, and then you'll be observing for nystagmus in the eyes. This is the way you normally look for nystagmus. If you do not see nystagmus when you examine like this, maybe the patient does not have nystagmus, but also it's possible that the patient has nystagmus and it's not shown up because of visual fixation can suppress nystagmus. Peripheral nystagmus or peripheral vertigo can get suppressed. Peripheral nystagmus can get suppressed by central mechanisms. So when you're examining for nystagmus like this, you may not see nystagmus. If you get rid of the fixation, you will be able to uncover nystagmus. But how are you going to get rid of fixation? You can use Frenzel glass, which is a biconvex lens, which is attached to the patient's eyes. This is like a binocular, and there is a light inside it because it's dark inside. There's a light to illuminate the eyes. And through these biconvex lenses, patient will not be able to see the outside world because it's blurred, so he will not be able to fix. But for the external examiner, we'll be able to see the eyes better through the biconvex lens, so you'll be able to observe the nystagmus. The Frenzel glass is a little costly, and there are more cheaper ones available right now. If you do not have them, you may use the ophthalmoscope to get rid of the visual fixation. How are we going to get rid of visual fixation? By using ophthalmoscope. What you do, you cover one of these eyes of the patient and you approach to look at the other eye, the optic nerve head, using the ophthalmoscope. And when you're approaching to look at inside the retina, you're going to cover that eye also. So the patient will not be able to fix. And you're looking at the optic nerve head, you're looking at the optic nerve disc, and you will start seeing nystagmus of the optic nerve disc. And because eye is a globe, when anterior end moves in one direction, the posterior end, the optic nerve disc area, should be moving in the opposite direction. So when you are observing the optic disc through the ophthalmoscope, you will see nystagmoid movement, but the direction is opposite. So point number three, fixation of vision when you examine for nystagmus, you may attenuate nystagmus if when you are fixing vision, that is in peripheral vertigo. But if the cause of the vertigo and the nystagmus is central of origin, fixation is not going to suppress the nystagmus. So when you use, when you get rid of fixation and you uncover nystagmus, that indicates the cause of the cause of the vertigo is peripheral and not central. And if the nystagmus is not suppressed by fixation, that indicates probably the lesion is central. And causes of nystagmus can be pendular or jerky. When it's jerky, you have a lot of differential diagnosis for nystagmus. And you can have pure nystagmus in the primary position. When the patient is looking straight ahead, nystagmus can be upbeat, downbeat, or torsional. I'm not going to go into the details of this. I will show some of the videos of certain nystagmus. But this slide is very important. You need to differentiate nystagmus whether it's peripheral or central. Few things. Nystagmus can be jerky and unidirectional, meaning it jerks towards one side only. So fast phase is always towards one side. Say for example, if the fast phase is to the left, even with the right gaze, the fast phase is going to be to the left. So whatever the gaze position, it always leads to the left side. That is unidirectional. When you say bidirectional, when you're looking at the left, the nystagmus leads towards the left. When you look at the right side, nystagmus leads towards the right side. When you look at upwards, it leads upwards and so on. So it's changing. Gaze evoked nystagmus, which is a central pathology, and unidirectional usually is peripheral. And the classic ones are for peripheral torsional upbeating and horizontal or torsional downbeating. And pure vertical nystagmus is never seen in peripheral vertigo. And visual fixation, as I said in the previous slide, suppresses nystagmus. And in central nystagmus, usually they are gaze evoked, meaning it beats to the side of the gaze. And you can also have pure downbeat or pure upbeating or pure torsional. And visual fixation does not suppress nystagmus in the central causes. So nystagmus helps differentiate peripheral from central causes of vertigo. A few words on the commonest pathology. I will take a few minutes because I understand a lot of medical students are listening to this lecture. And this is a diagnosis that all the doctors should understand because this particular problem is very common. This is the commonest cause. And it's treatable with a head maneuver almost 100%. And you don't need any medication to treat this. So they are usually brief, less than a minute. They are spells of vertigo provoked by head movements, either looking up, down. The usual story is I try to take something from the top of the almirah, or I wash my face, bent forward and then got up, or lying down in the bed or getting up from the bed, provoke these attacks. And sometimes they are preceded by head trauma because of dislodgement of autoconial trauma. And this happens due to calcium particles or dislodged particles from the autoconia in the semicircular canals, which is called canalolithiasis. And sometimes they can go into the cupula, which is called cupulolithiasis. And as I said, there were three semicircular canals. The commonest canal involved is posterior canal, 93%. And horizontal canals, 5%. And anterior canal is almost unheard, about 2%. And this is how the semicircular canals are placed, if you want to have a look. I show this picture to find out the commonest canal, which is the posterior canal. Which is at an 45 degrees angle to verticality. And also note on the right side image that the horizontal canal is not really horizontal, it's 30 degrees upwards from horizontally. So when you want to test any of these canals in the diagnostic maneuvers for benign paroxysmal positional vertigo, the theory, the principle is you bring this canal into the plane of motion. So you turn the head first to the plane where you want to move, and then move the head in that plane. So if you take the posterior canal on the right side, sorry, on the left side, if you want to bring into the plane of motion, you turn the head to the left side, and then the posterior canal is in line in with the forward direction in the plane, and then you will be bringing the head downwards so that you will be moving the head in the plane of the posterior canal, which sets a motion within the posterior canal, a relative motion within the posterior canal, bringing about the symptoms and the signs. So this is how you test for left posterior canal BPPV, Hall Pike's test. You turn the head 45 degrees to the left side and then go down above the edge of the bed. If you want to test the right posterior canal, you do the opposite. You turn the head to the right side, 45 degrees, and then go backwards above the edge, which will bring the symptoms as well as nystagmus. And this is a patient who had left posterior canal vertigo. Just see. Is it pain? And you're going to see nystagmus. This nystagmus is classic. There's a latency. It came after a while. And it's torsional and upbeating. It has a crescendo-decrescendo pattern. That is, the amplitude of the nystagmus gradually increases and then gradually wanes off. And then it lasts a very short period. So that is the characteristic nystagmus you're going to see with posterior canal BPPV. With this nystagmus, you diagnose that the lesion is in the left posterior canal. And then this position will be immediately followed with the treatment, that is Eplis. So that is the classic nystagmus of benign paroxysm position of vertigo. If this patient had the nystagmus coming immediately, probably this is not BPPV. And if the nystagmus lasts longer than a minute, it's not going to be BPPV. And if you see a nystagmus which is not upbeating torsional, it's not posterior canal. Now, sometimes when you do the hall pipes, you might see horizontal canal getting activated because the patient has horizontal canal BPPV. And your nystagmus direction will be different in such a situation. It will be horizontal. So if you see horizontal nystagmus, maybe it's not posterior canal. You're going to check for horizontal canal and the other maneuver. And this is what you're going to do to treat it. So as you finish the hall pipes in the same go, you turn the head to for 90 degrees to the opposite direction. That's number C. And then another 90 degrees lower down. And then keep each position about 20 seconds and then come back. And this is a live demonstration of how you're going to treat left or right posterior canal BPPV. 45 degrees to the right, go back, stay there for some time. And then you turn towards opposite side, 90 degrees. And then stay there for a few seconds and then another 90 degrees. And then stay for some time. And if you keep the head lower as possible, that will be the best for the treatment. And you can also use another maneuver to treat the posterior canal, that is Semon's maneuver, which is done like this. You turn the head to the right side, go to the first side and then immediately come back to the opposite side. This is also equally treatable like Eplis maneuver. It's almost 100% success rate. And for horizontal canal, you do a different maneuver which is called supine roll test. So you turn the head, start with the lie down facing up and then turn the head to say one side, say number two to the right side and then turn to the other side looking for nystagmus, and the classic nystagmus is horizontal. And because this is the horizontal canal, because if you look at the place where the particle is, when you turn the head to a side, you can see that when you turn to one side, the particle will move in one direction, and when you turn to the opposite side, the particles will be moving the opposite direction. So when you turn to left and the right side, the direction of the nystagmus is going to be different. It's going to change. Direction changing nystagmus. We saw direction changing nystagmus before with gaze evoked nystagmus, but here also is direction changing, but this direction change occurred due to head movement, not spontaneous. So when you turn the head to the left side, you see nystagmus is beating towards the ground when the head is like that. And when you change the head to the opposite side, again, the direction changes and then again beats towards the ground. So this is going to be geotrophic nystagmus. That is to indicate that the beating takes the fast phase is always towards the ground. So that indicates the particles is in the horizontal canal and it's in the lower arm of the horizontal canal. But when the, I'm going to demonstrate the video. Now the patient's head is supine. And turning to the right side, you can see you are looking at the left eye. It beats towards the right. So it beats towards the bottom, towards the ground. And now you change the head position to the opposite side. Classic nystagmus has a crescendo decrescendo pattern, and change the head position to the left in a moment. Now we're changing the head to the left side. You're going to see the direction of the nystagmus going to change, but because head has moved to the opposite side, it's again beating towards the ground. Now it's beating towards the left side. So this is geotrophic nystagmus, indicating it's horizontal canal BPPV and it's in the lower arm, not in the anterior arm. So this is the lower arm. Particles will produce geotrophic nystagmus, and upper arm should produce the opposite of geotrophic, where the nystagmus will be beating towards away from the ground, irrespective of the sides that you are turning to. So BPPV, first step is to identify the canal, and then is to have the particle repositioning maneuver to cure the BPPV. So commonly it's done for posterior canal, and rarely it's, you have to do it for horizontal canal. But if anyone learns posterior canal, that is more than enough, because horizontal canal usually, even if you do not treat, because the patients are usually turning on the bed, they spontaneously correct themselves. So posterior canal is the one which needs treatment. Anterior canal and the horizontal canal, generally they treat because of the natural head movements taking place when you're lying down, turning on the bed and so on. So just in summary, the various diagnostic maneuvers and the liberatory maneuvers I have mentioned here. Anyone wants to take a picture? And then because of time constraints, I will not go into details. You can read up and see the YouTube videos if you want to learn them. So peripheral vertigo, there are multiple causes. We were discussing some of them. Vestibular rehabilitation is another thing that we need to pay attention to. Most patients with vertigo, they tend to stay still, which is not going to be good, because for them to get better, actually, this system has to be activated. It promotes adaptation and strategic substitution, and they get better with rehabilitation. The more the symptoms are produced, the better they will, faster they will adjust. Usually this is for peripheral vertigo. Maybe there's a place for central vertigo also, but the physiotherapist should be able to give various exercises for eyes and head movements, bring about symptoms, and then help this compensation. Vestibular ocular reflex is a very important reflex as far as vertigo goes. And there is a horizontal canal sensing the head movements, and then immediately sending the impulses for both eyes to move in the opposite direction, real time, very fast, very efficient reflex. So when you fix your gaze towards a particular target and then you move your head horizontally to a side, you can keep the gaze fixed on that target thanks to this reflex. But if your VOR goes wrong, if your VOR is absent due to semicircular canal pathology or vestibular nerve pathology, your eyes will drift together with the head. You will not be able to fix your gaze towards that point of fixation. So head impulse test is a way of testing for this unilateral vestibular lesions. In the top two pictures, what I'm showing is the patient is able to keep the gaze fixed on your nose, even with turning to the left. If you look at the bottom three images, with the head moving towards the right side, the middle picture, you'll see that the eyes are moving together with the head. And then, because you have instructed the patient to keep looking at your nose, patient make a corrective circuit. So this test is a very important test at the bedside. So you hold the face on either side, make a slight movement, about 15 degrees, with a jerk, very fast, instructing the patient to keep the gaze fixed on your nose. The patient can keep it fixed, the gaze on your nose without corrective circuit, the VOR is intact on both sides. But if you see a correction saccade, then it indicates that VOR is absent, the vestibular pathology on the side that the head is turned to. So the side of the lesion is actually the direction that you are turning the head to. There's a video of the head impulse test. You can see head is turned to the right side first, the VR is intact, and to the left side you see the correction circuit. I'll replay it for you. Towards the right, patient can maintain the gaze. When the head is there to the left side, the eyes move together with the head and the correction circuit. So head shake test or head impulse test is a very useful bedside test to differentiate peripheral from central causes. If the head shake test is positive, it indicates a peripheral pathology. A few videos just to highlight some of the other causes. This is a patient who came with episodic vertigo, and if you observe the nystagmus here, he had a family history of ataxia, episodic ataxia. This patient was recently started on phenytoin for epilepsy, and then patient presents with this downbeating nystagmus. Whatever the direction of the gaze, it's downbeating nystagmus. Downbeating nystagmus is never peripheral, it's a central cause. This patient had episodic ataxia type 2, which can be treated with azithromycin. And here another example of a peripheral vestibular nystagmus. You are looking at the right eye, and patient is instructed to look straight now. You see some amount of nystagmus here, beating towards the left. And patient is instructed to look to the right side now. You see the nystagmus is attenuated or probably not there. And patient looks at the left side again. Nystagmus is having more amplitude now. So this actually demonstrates a peripheral nystagmus beating towards the same side, unidirectional. It always beats to the left side, and there is attenuation of the nystagmus when the patient is looking at the right side. So this is called Alexander's law. In unidirectional nystagmus, amplitude is more when the patient is looking towards the side of the fast face. And when you're looking towards the side of the slow face, amplitude is less. And another important sign in vertigo patients that you should look for, looking for central causes, is skew division. And skew division means vertical misalignment of the eyes. One eye is up, the other side is down, usually caused by supranuclear conditions. How you look for it is by alternate cover test or cross cover test, whatever the way you want to call it. You cover one eye and then alternately cover either eye, one after the other. And you see the opened eye always either go up, the other one goes down. So that's how you look for skew deviation. And this can be associated with ocular torsion and head tilt also, which I do not have time to explain the subjective visual vertical, which is tested by a bucket test. If you want to ask in the question time, I may explain it. With alternate cover test, you cover one eye at a time, looking for vertical saccade in open eye, which is skew deviation. And whether you have these hints, now someone coming with vertigo to the emergency with nystagmus, you must do this test. One is head impulse. Head impulse test I have described a few minutes ago. And then look for nystagmus, and then the test of skew. So these three together can differentiate peripheral causes and central causes. So head impulse test will be positive in peripheral pathologies, and nystagmus will have peripheral characteristics or central characteristics. Depending on that, you can differentiate whether it's peripheral or not. And test of skew will be positive in central. So with central pathologies, you will see head impulse will not be there, and nystagmus will have central characteristics and positive test of skew. This is important, someone coming with vertigo and nystagmus, and is almost equally sensitive in picking up with MRI scan for central nervous system lesions. So this is how you differentiate central from peripheral vertigo. So HINT test done in all patients presenting with persistent vertigo and nystagmus help differentiate peripheral from central etiologies. If you look at the central vertigo, in fact, this HINT test is useful in differentiating vestibular neuropathy and ischemic strokes of the cerebellum or brainstem. These are the two important ones that you have to differentiate in the emergency. And other central vertigo causes, if you look at vestibular migraine, I will not have time to go into the details, but most migraine, not most, but 10% migraine patients will have vertigo, and cerebellar pathology, and episodic ataxia type 2, I have shown you a video. Rotational vertebral artery syndrome is where when you rotate the head, you get vertigo due to kinking of the vertebral artery at the C1, C2 level. And if you want to take a picture of this, you can maintain, this is actually giving the central sites of lesion against the clinical findings. So this is going to be a little, you need a little time to explain this. So these are the central lesions that can be there against the various clinical findings you're going to observe. So you will have isolated vertical saccade palsy, and all these things has to be examined in a, when a patient comes with vertigo. Saccade palsies, pursuits, and then gaze holding and various nystagmus patterns will indicate where the site of lesion is. And in cerebellum, most lesions are actually have the most causes of vertigo is happening from flocculus and parafloculus region. And also it can be, lesion can be in the nodules. Nodular lesions can give rise to central positional nystagmus and periodic alternating nystagmus and so on. This is a bit of a long list. You might have to study slowly. So complete eye examination, including gaze holding, saccades, pursuits, optokinetic nystagmus. You have seen the optokinetic drum, which you place in front of the patient and look for optokinetic nystagmus, which is intact in normal people. And you can look for saccades and pursuit deficits when you use the optokinetic drum. And also you must look for fixation suppression of VOR. We have not gone into the details of that. Fixation suppression of VOR, where you place the patient on a rotating chair and then turn the patient while fixing the gaze on one target. So these needs for diagnostic workup. And that brings to the end. Thank you.